Hey, mister, I'm back. And this time, we're here with Scott Sigler. It's a literary bonanza. We read an audiobook version of his new short story, Beam Up on Aisle 5. It has original ideas come up by Chatrealm the last time he was on. Also, we get into a screaming argument about Star Wars. Ooh. Hey, mister, stay tuned. NSFW's coming up right now.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for NSFW is brought to you by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is NSFW episode 121, recorded on April 3rd, 2012. More crass than baby ass.
This episode is brought to you by Squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to create a high-quality website or blog. Ew! For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to Squarespace.com and use offer code NSFW4.
Welcome to Dalek relaxation for humans. Take a deep breath in through your nose. Now exhale through your mouth, softly. Focus on slowing down your breathing into a calm rhythm. Inhale. You are becoming more and more calm. Exhale. You are feeling more and more relaxed. Inhale, calm. Exhale, relaxed. Inhale, calm. Exhale, relaxed. Inhale, calm. Exhale, relaxed. Continue to breathe slowly and calmly. And stresses of daily life are floating away. Your tension has been exterminated. Exterminated!
And just like that, that means it is go time for NSFW, the new show full of wind, the new sauce for the Webernet, the show that is nominally safe for work. As always, I'm your host, Brian Brushwood, joined by the inimitable co-host. He was once a little bird, left abandoned beneath a tree, but then he was stepped on by Justin Robert Young. What's going on, Justin Robert Young?
Oh, holy crap, Brian. I thought this day would never come. This is a long-awaited episode, if you're a listener to the NSFW show, that we see the triumphant return of somebody who was on maybe the funniest episode we've done in the last year and a half.
Well, I'll tell you, it was easily one of the most fun episodes. It was like, it was easy. It was like swimming in butter covered in nipples. It was buttery nipples. Butter. Yeah.
It was like we had a bunch of nipples that were in a pool of butter, like kind of like mint chocolate
Actually,
chip.
When I think of nipple butter, I think of more like you go around cutting off nipples and you grind them down to a pasty butter and then you
But some
smear
people
it.
Like it not so fine. They like the chunks. Like
peanut butter.
So chunky nipples. Now with chunky nipples.
Yeah, there you go. I can think of
no better introduction than the author of Nocturnal, which is released in hardcover today. You can find it on Amazon either in a physical form or on your Kindle e-reader. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, legendary author Scott Sigler is back.
Huzzah, yes. Dude. Looking like a boss right there in the Twit Studios because you are hanging out. You just made an appearance on Sword and Laser. You decided to come slum
on a show that's way better than this one.
Yeah.
And then I thought I would sit back in the chair like a boss. And this is a good boss chair to sit back in right here.
You do look. I think that's why it's for the boss. I think traditionally that's Leo's chair.
If I lean up, I got this going on.
You got a halo.
Holy corona of power above my
head. Hey, what's up?
I like it.
What's up? Where's your, I got a halo.
Oh, crap. I don't know.
Scott's got a halo. You's got a jumble of messes. There we go. Close enough.
It's not bad. It's not bad.
I got a halo now, too.
Perry Bible Fellowship. Go pick it up after you buy Scott's book.
Oh, my God. That was a great book, by the way.
All right. So, Scott, you were telling me before the show that you've been doing press for Nocturnal. Today's a big release day. You've been getting out there, talking to a bunch of people, making sure they know that they can go out and buy it. But you said you've been looking forward to one thing. Throughout all the interviews, all the questions, there's one point that you've been looking forward to today. And what is that?
I've been very much looking forward to the return of Meth Cow and getting back and reading the story that I wrote based on all the crazy stuff that we did last time. So, yeah,
if you're wondering, if you don't remember last time, it was a little gem we put up together. We gave you, we sketched out, as we try to help out as faux producers, sort of kind of give you an idea of what we wanted. And we knew that Beam Up on Aisle 5, a story of Chad Letilton, Brock Sockman, Carney Cow, and Rabbi Joseph Manischewitz in New Hoboken at the Walmart. We knew it would be a hit, and we're excited to take a little look at it right here. Now, is this available yet, or is this only available here? Where can people get their mitts on this?
Well, actually, the story is part of the short story collection Bones Are White, which is available in it's in the Amazon ebook store right now. And coming online in the other ebook stores. I'm not sure if they're up. I'm sure my business partner, Ray Kovacs, probably in the chat realm explaining where people can get it. But scottsigler.com/store, there's a place you can buy it there. Or just go to Amazon, search for Bones Are White, or search for Scott Sigler, and you will find the short story collection, Bones Are White, in which we have Beam Up on Aisle 5. So we made that kind of the anchor piece of the short story collection. So. It's really cool. So now we're here. Now we're here, and all the people in the chat room can buy Nocturnal, and they can buy Beam Up on Aisle 5, and they have no money left for their children, and their children will cry, and that brings me power.
No, that's good. Well, at least it elevates you by pushing everyone else down just a few more notches, which is, I think, the important thing.
You sit piled high on a big heap of tear soaked bills. You just scream and yell down to the plebeians.
Okay,
well, so at very least, I think people really should check out the short story collection because, I mean, I don't know that anybody's ever done this other than you guys on a show like this. You came up with all the elements for the story, we wrote it, and now it looks professional. That's the spooky thing. It looks like we actually intended to write the story and put it in there, so it's pretty cool.
Well, I mean, that's what I was going to say, is I thought for sure it was going to be like three paragraphs, like, I don't know, here's some references, make your kids happy. But instead, it was eminently readable. I really enjoyed the story.
Right? Yeah, it is great. Now, real quick, if you happen to not listen to the first episode that Scott was on, you should, number one, stop this episode, go back and listen to it. But here is the real quick recap. We came up with, like Brian showed the cover before, just basic character names and a very basic plot. Yeah, I mean, it was more just a conflict. We came up with an initial conflict.
It was a series of dares that we dared him to write into a sensible story. And he pulled off all of them and then some. This thing is maggoty with NSFW show references. I couldn't believe it as I read it. And we're gonna read some samples of it. We're actually going to work out a little bit of audiobook samples. But first, why don't we take a look at, you have a trailer for Nocturnal that you just released, what, a day or two ago? How long ago?
Today. This it came out Nocturnal is in stores I as of right hunt. Now, as of today.
Awesome. My brothers and I find the weak. Those who won't be missed. We stalk. We catch. We feed. After each kill, we draw the symbol to stay safe. Darkness is ours. I always wake horrified at what I've done. Wondering why I still feel the blood on my tongue. Sickened that it tastes so good. Oh God, this can't be real. I'm a monster or a monster dreaming I'm a man.
I'm in love with this whole trend of trailers for books. I'm so glad that everybody's up and on, not only with the big major releases, but with independents and ebooks releases as well. Was this just, have you done trailers for your other books, or was this the first one that you did that with?
No, I've done a trailer for all the books going back to Infected back in 2008. We did a trailer for that.
Wow.
We did one for Contagious, then one for Nocturnal. And we tried to up-level the budget in Nocturnal and do kind of a live-action trailer. It turned out pretty cool at the monster CGI. Looks pretty good, but we thought with this one, we would go full animation and try and do like an enhanced comic book style approach. So,
well, it's got that right
I've been
balance.
Doing them all along because they go up on YouTube and they just stay there forever. And every other way you spend money to promote a book, it's there and it's gone in a week, but the YouTube just sits there and plays and plays and plays for years.
Well, and it's it does what it needs to do in that the motion graphics look really tight and it's got a distinct style that that allows you to draw the rest of the pictures with your mind, but it shows a certain level of production quality. So, you know, this isn't, you know, a horse apples production, that you guys are doing some legit work.
Yeah, the art was done by a guy out of Detroit named John Dunavant, who does this thing called Theater Bazaar, which people should look up. It's insane. They take a whole abandoned block of Detroit and turn it into this giant goth circus. It's nuts.
He did
the art. And then Kevin Capizzi did the animation for it. And then we were lucky enough to get Toby Turner to Tobuscus to do the voiceover for it, and his fans eat it up, and I'm so happy with it. Awesome.
I mean, look at the counts on this thing. It's already up to 20,000 views, and it's only been out like 5 days. It's freaking amazing.
Yeah, it's been out. Great.
It's fantastic, and it really is. I think for a book like yours, you really made a smart decision in terms of trying to figure out what is a good stylistic way that you can illustrate what the experience that you're going to get on you know, a budget that makes sense for a YouTube trailer like that. I mean, it just, I don't know. It's tens all around. I think it's an amazing work of art in and of itself.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right. So before we get into our production.
You had a news story.
It's a news story is right. I don't know what this is. I don't know what to think about it. I don't know if it's an abomination. I don't know if it's good or bad, but there are videos of this leaking.
I hope it's what I think it is.
All over the internet. And it's little gems like this for Star Wars Connect.
Dude, I thought this was a joke.
No, it most certainly is not.
Oh my God.
Now listen.
Feeling free and it feels so right. Oh, time to do the things I like. Gonna see a
what happened to Lucas's heart?
Okay. All right, for the audio listeners, if you're not able to tell what happens, this is footage from the Star Wars Kinect game, which I guess at some point has you swinging a lightsaber, because that's the only thing anyone wants in the goddamn universe. But in addition to that, they have a whole dancing Jedi mode. But
it looks like they use one of the Just Dance or whatever engines.
Sure.
You know.
But the significant thing is that they decided that they needed to sing to like a Weird Al Yankovic style parody to Riding Solo, only with the lyrics changed to be about the fact that he's Han Solo. And when this
and that's not the only one.
No, this is just it. This is over at Kotaku. Look at this. They got this is Princess in a Battle. You gotta
hold on, to the tune of Christina Aguilera's Genie in a Bottle.
I want to punch someone in the face.
So I
no, you had about my favorite. My favorite is Kashyyyk to Jamiroquai's Canned Heat, which I very much enjoy.
No, is that what that is? I haven't clicked on it because I didn't know which one it is. Dude, I loved Canned Heat. Don't do that to Jamiroquai. Are you kidding me? All right, so hold on. So first of all, does it bother anyone else that the set pieces are places where like they froze freaking Han Solo in Carbonite.
This for the audio listeners, what they're doing is the dancing is either taking place in Jabba's palace or in the pit where they encased Han and Carbonite on Cloud City.
Yeah, these.
Now listen, Brian, listen to this, and tell me that this doesn't sound like Jamiroquai.
You know this Wookiee is for real?
I used to put my faith in starships.
Oh, this is so wrong. This is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. This is horrible.
I just want to get Scott's face.
There's not enough beer in the world to erase the memory of this. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing.
So here's the thing. I went ahead. Here, I'll go ahead and so we can constantly watch it. Let me throw this down here. I put this up on my Google Plus with the comment that just said, and just like that, Star Wars had all the credit of Vanilla Ice. And somebody got like, that's all them fighting words, saying like, hey, man, if you tried it, it's fun. You know, it might be fun for kids and games. And you need to think about it before you just say that. And it's like, here's the problem. You gotta, and I mentioned this on the instance earlier, Vanilla Ice had the best-selling rap album in all of history, but he didn't know when to stop saying yes. He said yes to Tiger Beat magazine. He said yes to the ninja rap with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and all of a sudden...
Go Ninja Go.
He was nothing but a joke, and he never, ever recovered. Somebody make the case for me where this is not George Lucas's Tiger Beat moment, Vanilla Ice epic.
Yeah, I'll make that argument. Because I tweeted about this yesterday with the tweet, somebody made a silly dance game about a 35-year-old franchise that's been parodied and made a joke a billion times. Who cares? This is hilarious. It's completely ridiculous, completely over the top. And if you don't like it, don't buy it. But there's a reason why we pay attention to it, because it's so completely on Mars. They made parody songs, and you can dance as Lando Calrissian.
No,
as
I
a
disagree.
Ball
I think Billy
comes
D.
out
Williams
of the carbonite
is going to get a tire iron. He's going to go to the Lucas Ranch, and he's going to dictate policy. Billy, he's not going to be happy with this.
So, see, here's the problem: is you don't perceive that this is taking away anything from anyone, but it's like,
no.
But it is when it comes from the factory itself. When it comes from Lucas itself, all of a sudden. Like, I feel a little bit dumb loading up freaking Star Wars The Old Republic
This is cheaper than putting Han Solo on Lunchables and disposable diapers and every possible thing on the planet. Like, this is somehow more insidious and more crass than that.
It is more insidious because when he's on a diaper, he's just getting poo on his face. He's not like, snazoo, let's get this dance on. You know, that's...
Bonnie,
not the same thing.
Bonnie just tweeted saying that this is not ironic fun. This is not like you're in on the joke. This is your grandpa dancing hilariously, having no idea how dumb and drunk he looks at the wedding.
This is your grandpa doing a striptease dance with your grandma at your wedding. That's what this is.
Yes.
Okay. No, but here's the point. If this were a mod, right? Let's say someone just made a skin where they made original parodies for these songs, and it was a skin to Just Dance, and it didn't have Lucasfilm's thing on it, and it just came out on Kotaku and Joystick and all the other video game blogs one day, and it just blew up. Everyone would think it was goddamn hilarious. But because it has the Lucasfilm name on it...
Oh, wait. Oh, dang it. Sorry, go ahead.
Just read what she's saying.
Bonnie wrote, more crass than baby ass. So now she's rhyming like she's Don King.
I know. Yeah, she's like Muhammad Ali.
Okay, but here's the thing.
Did you deny that if this were a skin to Just Dance, everyone would find hilarious?
Yes, and if somebody had taken Vanilla Ice's album and cut it to be a hilarious Go Ninja Go rap, that would have been hilarious. But instead, Vanilla Ice took the paycheck and got up and flushed his career down the toilet to do a ninja rap that everybody hated and was utterly stupid. That's what's happening here. It does matter.
Vanilla Ice is not a 35-year-old franchise that's been run through the muck. Literally every opportunity for either somebody to parody it or for them to embarrass themselves has been taken with aplomb. Lucasfilm has done nothing but embarrass this franchise repeatedly. At least this is a joke. At least this is fun. At least this is silly.
couldn't they put some of this energy into making another movie? Come on. Like, okay, they were the second three or first three, whatever, weren't the greatest things in the world, but I'll still watch them. Like, go make another movie. That's a good way to make money. You had a movie that made a buttload of money. Make another movie to make more buttloads of money. Not this crazy ass dancey. Oh God, I'm sorry. I think you're right about the skin thing. You're totally right. It would be very hysterical and funny. I'm betrayed. I'm outraged.
So this lessens what I'm getting from you guys is this lessens the Star Wars universe to you. You don't want to pick up the after books about General Thrawn. You don't want to put in Empire Strikes Back. It makes you feel differently about that, having seen this side game joke in a video game that either of you will probably play.
Well, look at it this way. All of a sudden, I picture someone walking in the room while I'm playing Star Wars The Old Republic, and now there's the risk that they're going to be like, oh, I love this game. It's hilarious. And I'm like, no, asshole. It's Star Wars The Old Republic. It's the MMO. This is one of the most thoughtful sci-fi, massively multiplayer games ever created. They're like, oh, but my nephew loves it. Will you do the dancing? It's like, this is taking something away. And when your reputation matters.
In the same way that whenever you see Boba Fett in Empire or Jedi, you're like, oh, that's the guy from the Christmas special. I love him.
Well, no, that's not a good example. The right example is like, oh, that's a cute little kid from the prequels. Look at him all grown up. And yes, took something away from Boba Fett to show him as a stupid little kid.
No,
and you know what? I managed to block out the Christmas special. I saw that as a young lad. And I watched, like, Chewbacca having a nice, tender Christmas moment. I'm like, no, he shoots people in the face with a laser crossbow. That's what he does. Then he complains about fixing the toilet on the Millennium Falcon. He does not have a happy, happy, joy, joy Christmas. It ruined it for me, and I blocked it out.
You should meet Lumpy and then punch him in the head for not getting good grades.
I understand.
That's how you handle it on Kashyyyk.
I understand that you're in love with being the devil's advocate, but you can't deny that it takes something away when something this dorky is associated with the franchise.
I'm saying dorkier stuff has been associated with this franchise. This is at least this is silly. At least there was an element of humor that's put into this. When you have a mirror ball lifting up from the carbonite pit, this is a deliberate joke.
Well, no, nobody's accusing it of not being a deliberate joke. If I gave the impression that I thought this was serious.
Then it's a state-sponsored joke.
Well, that's just it. Is with comedy, I almost won the belt just now. It does matter when the state is the one trying to make the joke. It makes it unfunny, and it makes the entire thing unfunny.
Well, the thing is, at least as someone who does also create stuff and would like to create something at that level, but probably never will, because the Star Wars franchise it happens once a generation. Star Wars, Harry Potter, that kind of thing. But you expect the creators of this to have some level of integrity to the story. And I think it's a bit heartbreaking when you find out that they don't, that all they care about is how many zeros are on the next paycheck, and they'll do anything to get more money when they already have so much freaking money. And it's a bit of a disillusionment, and it kind of breaks your heart. Plus, it's wrong.
I completely agree that, you know, when you completely flood the market and you put your name on everything and you are just a gigantic brand where really all you're trying to do is sell dolls and sell lightsabers and keep this money machine going. But it's hard for me to get upset about this for a franchise that has already put out how many crappy other things. I mean, the stupid Clone Wars movie that came out 2 years ago that everybody's already forgotten about. No one's going to care about this outside of 48 hours from now. And in the grand scheme of crimes that George Lucas has committed in terms of his intellectual property, at least this is trying to be a joke. It's not trying to be good and failing horribly. Like the prequels,
the Clone Wars movie,
like you really 90,000 like other things that they've done.
You like to dance, and you've got the music in you. You got it right here, and you want to shake it.
I really like the Kashyyyk song. I'm not even going to lie.
Can't wait.
All right. Well, so I guess...
feels tonight, baby. I will say also that on Game On this week, I proposed a sketch that would have involved this, and it was shot down because apparently I had the same idea of somebody at Revision 3 that is already doing that sketch. Mm. But it was going to happen. Gotten up and hopefully they'll come out with it and it'll be funny.
It would have been a great, yeah, it would have been great, man. You don't think they could have covered the same thing and made it fun without going the Weird Al Yankovic route, though? It turns it into a Disney
thing. Would it be better for you if they used pop music and didn't have it be Star Wars centric? Would help.
Well, it wouldn't be this if it was. Here's the thing. If you ask me what I love about the Star Wars universe, I love that it's a vast, dangerous, dark, gritty world. It is a galaxy in rebellion where smugglers can shoot someone under the table and take care of it with a coin tip, where people get into scuffles at bars and arms get lopped off. It's a kludgy world where all of the sci-fi tech is patched together and everything's filthy and dirty. It's awesome and it's epic and it's as far as my imagination can go. And I don't like things that make it a silly place. It makes me want to associate with it less if this is what people think of when they think of the Star Wars world. Because then diminishes
the brand. If you want to get into the marketing perspective, and granted, they know more about this than I ever will because of the 17 zeros in every paycheck. But like Brian says, it diminishes the brand. You can't play Star Wars Old Republic now, because every time you watch a stormtrooper, you're going to wait for him to just start whipping it around, you know?
They dance in Old Republic.
Yeah, they do, but that's our dance.
And you tweeted that out, like, oh, look at how hilarious it is that they dance in Old Republic.
Yeah, but correct. And it's clever. It's awesome as a tiny thing, not as the big, you know, not as a well, dancing
game. That's not the game. It's not just dance Star Wars. This is part of a suite of things that you can do with the Kinect and in the Star Wars way, okay, right?
But again, you're not addressing either me or what Scott's saying. I believe this diminishes the brand, and you're saying it doesn't at all.
I'm saying not. It does not diminish the brand any further than it's been diminished by a billion pounds of crap that's been stupid baby nonsense, including the prequels, including the stupid Clone Wars movie, including any other cash-in nonsense garbage that's come out of Lucasfilm. I just have a hard time getting worked up about something that I'll defend it. I think it's a funny gag. I think it's a silly party thing. If you're drinking with your friends and all of a sudden you want to do the with Lando Calrissian dance to I'm a Princess in a Battle, that everyone's having a good time and we all high five and then you make out with the girl that you wanted to kiss.
Yeah, because when I play this video game, I know there's going to be a lot of making out with girls coming right after this.
Fair Maybe enough. Not. Maybe you make out with yourself in the mirror.
You know what they need to do next? They need to do Judge Vader. Take the Judge Judy model, put Vader up on the podium, and you can have plaintiffs and bailiffs come in, and it would, like, that would be a little bit better than this, I think, don't you?
Sure. No, look, I mean, like, if this is the new line to cross, I mean, there's no shortage of other things that we could do.
We've already crossed the line. There is no line anymore. Okay, there's no boundary.
You realize that if that was the case, if that was remotely true, we wouldn't be talking about this. We're not talking about this because
I'm shocked that people were upset about it. Okay. I guess that's my perspective. I can only say it from my perspective. I was surprised that there was a backlash to this because I thought it was silly. I don't think it was any different than any of the crap that's come out. And if anything, I think that this was deliberately trying to be, let's be as over the top and crazy as we can with this idea. And I think they succeeded doing it. And at least there was a plan and they achieved what they wanted to do, as opposed to trying to force down our throats, hey, here are three movies that are like the Star Wars trilogy. And then they're complete nonsense garbage like the prequels were. That was a lie. We were fed a bill of goods,
you know,
and
then
we're forced to waste time in our lives.
I could actually, I think we could come to an agreement on this. If I had to choose to warp time and space to where either this continued to exist or the prequels, you're right. This I would have 20 sequels to this game before I would have the sequels.
All right. Well, listen, I guess people are screaming and yelling about we've gone on too long.
Person is screaming and yelling, but yes.
I don't know. I can talk about it a while, but you want to know, we maybe get back to it. Let's do our first scene from Beam Up on Aisle 5. What do you say to that?
All right, here we go. So, again, beam up on aisle five. The short synopsis is, of course, we have a series. What would you put on the jacket, the dust jacket for the book on this, Scott?
I would say a gritty urban detective story of desperate lost people set in the space station of New Hoboken.
Yeah, right on.
Yeah.
Now, the first scene that we're going to take, this is actually the beginning of the story. I was thinking, and let me clear with you guys that Scott, you guys, we have a who's right vote. I guess we'll get to this throughout the show, but it's who's right. Jury is right. The brand has been pooped on already. Let's have fun. Or two, Schwood is right. It tarnishes the brand. Brian, what's the URL that people can go vote at?
It looks like strawpoll.me/523 to vote. Strawpoll.me/523.
And right now I'm holding a lead, but it's very fluid. It's a very, very fluid voting. So we'll see as we come up on that. But all right, Brian, so you can you will play Brock Sockman.
You got it. Brock Sockman, right, of course, is the muscle in this group. He's big, maybe a little bit dull. Not the sharpest tool in the shed, would you say?
Yep. He is a active heavyweight MMA fighter, not a champ by any stretch of the imagination. Had a couple qualifying matches that he could have moved up to the number one contender spot, but he's lost all three of those. So he is, top 20, but he's never going to be the champ.
We need some kind of mood music here to sort of set the tone. I don't know if I can find any. Oh well, we'll just have to add it after the fact. All right,
The author, of course, Scott, you are going to play, because I'll tell you what, I couldn't read this without reading your voice as the rabbi. Okay. You are going to read the rabbi, and also you will, unless you want me to do the narration, whatever's easier for you.
I'll be happy to do the narration and the rabbi.
Do the narration and the rabbi. So we set our scene in Walmart. This is scene one of our four-part reading of Beam Up on Aisle 5. By Scott Sigler, original characters by Chatrealm.
All right, here we go. Scene one in Walmart.
I like Walmart.
That's you have to say Brock said.
I have to say Brock said.
Yeah, because you're the
narrator. Take two.
All right, there we go. All right,
here we go.
Scene one in Walmart.
I like Walmart.
Brock said.
Can we get some snacks when we're done? Hungry.
Now, I said. I told you to eat before we left.
I did.
Brock said.
I ate a pot pie and a loopster.
Loopsters. So disgusting. Ground insect biomass pressed into a mold, then spray painted with an instantly hardening chitin. I'd rather eat the ass end of a camel, and those have been extinct for centuries. They grow insects in the middle of the station. Suckers get real big in lower G, I'm told. I try not to think about the fact that the bug's main food source is human waste. The mayor is all big on her self-sustaining by 70 campaign. God's damn Greens Party. New Hoboken is a space station, not farmland. Food's always going to be imported, no matter how many times bugs become food, which becomes poop, which becomes food for bugs, and so on. Still, the ground-up bugs are edible. Good protein. A budget-conscious heavyweight like Brock's gotta eat, I guess. 245 pounds requires a lot of intake just to keep going. And the way that guy trains, I'm not surprised he eats lobsters. As long as he keeps away from the Beff and the Begs, I'm good. So much in Walmart. Who buys this? 2-for-1 exosuits? Yeah, like I'm going to go hole crawling in a bargain exosuit on a sale bin next to 10 packs of freeze-dried mice on one side and 40-ounce bottles of Darm beer on the other. Brock stopped at an end cap and picked up a 30-roll toilet paper bundle. He smiled his missing incisor smile and held it up so I could see it, as if I couldn't see a goddamn cubic meter of ass wipe just fine.
Rabbi, it's only $99.
Brock said.
That's a bargain. We should get a cart.
Brock, you giant pile of retard. We're here on business. This ain't the time for coupon scanning. Put it down.
Brock's smile faded.
Rabbi, I was here yesterday and they had a sale on canned figs.
And how many cans did you eat?
Three,
he said.
And another for breakfast before I had the lobster. It's not agreeing with me is all I'm saying.
It wasn't that Brock had a sensitive digestive system, per se. It was more that he couldn't stop eating food that gave him the Hoboken hot step.
Brock, we're not here to shop. Come on, we're running late. We were supposed to get the president before he came in. Can we hurry it up?
End scene.
So there we go.
This is good. We've set that stage.
Nicely done.
All right. Hey, let's take a quick moment before we go on our second part here and thank the people who make this show possible, Justin.
Absolutely, Brian. How important are the people that make this show possible? Well, they're really important.
Pretty important.
So important that I gotta remember to bring up what they have to say so I don't screw it up.
I think you're talking about the fine folks over at Squarespace.com. That's right, Squarespace, the one place you want to go to create a high-quality blog portfolio or any kind of site. They've got all kinds of badass templates that make your stuff look like you know what you're doing, even though you don't have to know a lick of HTML5. All you need to know is how to go to Squarespace.com and use promo code NSFW4 at checkout, where you could get 10%. That's right. 10% off your first purchase. And if you buy a whole year in advance, that's 10% off for a whole year. If they let you, you could buy 100 years. 100 years in advance at 10% off. You'd save enough to send somebody to college, provided it's a very cost-effective college.
The College of Cost Effectiveness, their mascot is the calculators.
That's code NSFW4. You know, what do you like about Squarespace, Justin?
I like Squarespace because it functions as your passport. You just walk up to customs and you show them a Squarespace site and be like, I did that. And I got 10% off by using NSFW4 at checkout. And they're like, oh, shoot. You did that? Really? Really? You go on. You got to go on. That's what they say. That's actually what happens when you go through customs. You can go to Romania, China, Tibet. Literally anywhere. It doesn't matter as long as you have a Squarespace site.
See, that's weird because I thought what I like the most about Squarespace is that you could sign up for a free trial and they don't ask for a credit card or nothing. Within seconds, you could set world records setting up a website so fast just by going to squarespace.com. We thank them for their support, NSFW4.
You also get a free scimitar in the mail.
That's not true.
That's totally true.
Not at all true.
They'll send you a scimitar.
That's not true.
And then they'll say, don't slice your enemy's face off with it. Wink.
Okay.
It's actually in one of those cards, like those talking cards.
With those two guys. Characters. What's up?
Since you were talking about sponsors, I just got a text from my business partner, A. Kovacs. She says that if people buy Bones Are White on Amazon, I tweeted the link to the unfiltered chat realm. I closed the regular chat realm and I can't figure out how to get it back open again. If they purchase it and email the receipt to ak@scottsigler.com, every book that we sell, you guys get a dollar. We're sponsors now. What's up?
Wait a minute. So if they buy this short story, they're going to kick some money to us, to me and Justin?
That's right. Yeah. Every copy of Bones Are White we sell, not Nocturnal, because that's different, but every copy of Bones Are White we sell.
That's got the important one.
And then email the receipt to ak@scottsigler.com. Every copy we sell, we'll give you guys a buck.
It's funny you said that, Scott, because I just got a text message from my business partner, Troll McTrollington, who said that if we get enough dollars, it will go directly to a fund to buy Brian the Star Wars Connect game.
Oh my gosh. Bonnie just called me and said that if we get enough to get the Star Wars Connect game, we'll take video and post it online of me playing this horrific abomination. And I'll have a shit-eating grin on my face.
Oh, you're going to have to do the Falcon, though.
That's right. Sure. Because I'll be Han Solo, is what Bonnie just told me. All right, look, let's make some beautiful art here. Scene two. All right,
we pick up our story.
Should we explain what happens in the meantime? We should kind of give an overview, right?
Yeah, basically things have not gone well for Brock and the rabbi. They were going to go and take care of some business with the president. Things went awry, and now they have to go return to the person who hired them for the job, and that is the dangerous, the mysterious.
Wait, okay, yeah.
Crime overlord, Chad Latilton.
Right, they have to go back and say they were not able to accomplish their mission. Somebody sent us a bit of back.
Yes.
All right, you ready?
Nice. All right, here we go. I will be playing the role of Chad Latilton.
All right, here we go.
There was a buzzing sound, then the clank of hidden metal bars sliding back. The door opened. Inside waited another world, a noisy one full of thumping music. None of the ghetto dinginess here. Chad Latilton liked a club. The man himself was in the middle of a lighted dance floor. Colors flashed from the sides, from above and below. He shook his moneymaker, twisted, and turned. I don't know how he didn't sweat in a pink three-piece suit like that, especially with a matching fedora, but he was all smiles and sexy eyes for the five girls dancing with him. Those girls. For a price, you could have any of them. A big price. Those girls were the reason that Brock Sockman had to do muscle jobs like this. He made big bucks for his fights, and he spent those bucks on working girls. The hottest hookers in New Hoboken were on that floor, dancing along with Chad Latilton. And at the back edge of the glowing dance floor, I saw the thing of rumors, the thing that made Chad Latilton so feared. There was a body on the floor. I'm no doctor, but judging by the knife handle sticking out of his chest, I felt safe in assuming the guy was dead. There was a fuzzy little dog standing on the guy, its little front paws close to the knife, its rear paws balancing on the corpse's face. No, not standing. The dog was squatting.
It's true,
Brock said.
Pockets really does that?
I nodded. There had always been a rumor that Chad Latilton had trained his Pomeranians to shit on the forehead of his dead enemies. It was so ridiculous, such an outlandish gangster legend that I assumed it was just a myth. Well, it wasn't. I walked onto the dance floor, now dreading the meeting even more. He saw us coming. Latilton stopped doing the robot and shifted to a slow, side-to-side sway.
Ooh, Rabbi, big ugly,
he said.
You have the funds I sent you to procure?
There was a problem, Mr. Latilton, I said. The president.
You're not dancing,
Latilton said.
Something wrong with my music? You don't like my club? Ooh.
Damn, did I hate coming here. No, Mr. Latilton, this place is awesome. I started dancing, if you can call it that. I tried my best to emulate Latilton's sway. I felt the floor shaking beneath me from Brock's big feet. Sockman liked to boogie. Latilton smiled.
Ew, there you go, my man. Dancing will set you free. Now go on with your story.
There was a small problem, I said. Someone killed President John Conn. Latilton nodded, adjusted his fedora.
So I heard. I don't care about that. What I care about is the money I sent you to get from me.
I stopped dancing for a moment and started up as soon. Damn it. As soon as I realized I wasn't obeying Latilton's weird protocol.
I just told you the president is dead. How can I get money from a dead man? The job is done.
Latilton did three spins, eyes locking on me each time they came around. He stopped and stared, his hands near his hips, his fingers snapping to the beat.
I sent you to get my money, Rabbi. You don't have my money. Ew, ergo, the job's not done.
He put his hands on his hips and shook them side to side. A girl fell in on either side of him, grinding against him and matching his movements.
You took a job, Rabbi,
Latilton said.
If you had done that job and got to the president sooner, the president would not be dead and I would have my money. Ew! Therefore, this is your fault. You either finish the job I hired you to do, or someone's gonna come collect the money from you.
I stopped dancing. Latilton did not. Judging from the vibrations rattling the floor, neither did Brock Sockman. Latilton grabbed a girl and pulled her close. They stepped together, their feet matching 1, 2, 3 forward, then 1, 2, 3 back. He tilted his head toward the corpse with a little pile of Pomeranian poop on his forehead.
Rabbi, you see Shecky Goldberg back there? He disappointed me. If you don't bring me that money, I'll be disappointed in you.
And see.
Man, this is getting good.
So there we go. Now a complication. Our heroes have to go clean up the mess.
So to speak. Not the poop on the corpse. They don't have to clean up the poop or the corpse.
No. So this is in another part of New Hoboken, and they have to go down to the... They've been in the moderate rent district. Now they have to go down to the low rent district in order to go to Carney Con Carney's Bar.
Carney Con Carney's Bar. Now, of course, you remember from last episode based on a certain characteristic cow. Or yeah, it was Carney Cow, right?
Yep.
The meth cow. Okay.
Yeah. Well, the Carney Con Carney.
But this is different, though.
a different character, and she goes in the back with Brock.
Yes.
Because she is a sexual deviant and Brock is to her liking. And meanwhile, the rabbi is left out to tend bar, and he happens upon a conversation with a strange Scott Gertz himself to try to get through this scene.
This is going to be tough. I should have waited to have the beers until after this.
All right. You ready?
It's all right. I'm a pro. Showtime. All right. Here we go.
Let's get an over and under on how many times I can break Scott reading this.
Well, I'm not off to a good start.
Here we go. Keep it together. Keep it together, man.
All right. Here we go.
Scene 3 at Carney Con Carney's bar.
One of the three bar patrons stumbled away out the door. The other two asked for refills. The first on a Boilermaker, the second on a Tom Collins. I gave them Jack and Coke. Neither of them said a thing after the first sip, furthering my hypothesis that all mixed drinks are just variations on whiskey and carbonated sugar water. I'm a scientist like that.
Hey, mister.
I looked at the two bar patrons. They were still staring into their Boilermaker and their Tom Collins, respectively. They didn't look like they'd said anything.
Hey, mister. Down here.
I turned to look at the end of the bar. The guy lying there on the bar had his head up and was looking at me. His gray stubble face pulled back into a smile of mostly missing teeth. The ones that remained were a delightful shade of chartreuse.
Connie said you wanted to know something about the president.
Ah, poor Brock. I can see to it that you hear what you need to hear, Carney had said. She'd never mentioned exactly who would give me that information. I walked down to the end of the bar. Halfway there, I smelled the guy's breath. Drugs of some kind, for sure. Who does that to their body? I mean, people make fun of fighters because we choose to get the shit kicked out of us, get broken noses and split lips, suffer impaired vision for the rest of our lives, even get brain damage, sure, but drugs? I stopped in front of the guy. That's you.
No, that's...
I think it's Rabbi. I'm sorry. That's my bad. Yeah. I stopped in front of the guy. What do you know? He smiled wider.
Mister, I sure am thirsty. How about a sea breeze?
That figured. I poured him a Jack and Coke. I grabbed a red plastic sword out of a glass full of them, stuck an olive on it, put that in his drink, and handed him the glass. He stared at it.
That's not a sea breeze.
It's what you're drinking, asshole. He looked at me and raised his eyebrows.
Yeah, so it is.
He knocked it back in one pull.
Mmm, delicious.
I took the glass from him, accidentally touching his fingers as I did. His skin felt oily, clammy, repulsive. Why don't people like this just eat a bullet and get it done faster? The president, I said. What do you know? The green tooth smile returned. His eyes narrowed in delight. I knew that look. He thought he had power and was going to get something he wanted. Something more than just a sea breeze.
Hey, mister.
He said.
I saw your friend went into the back with Con Connie. Maybe if you go back with me, I'll tell you something you want to hear. I want to show you something.
I nodded. Maybe. I reached over and grabbed all the little red plastic swords out of the glass. There had to be 50 of them. And maybe I'll have to have you show me that something, then see how many of these I can stab into it. I held out the handful of red plastic swords. He stared at them, his eyes widening. I reached over and grabbed a little paper umbrella. And when I'm out of swords, I'll put this on the top. He shook his head.
Jeez, mister, never mind. And I thought I was a little kinky.
I forced myself to lean in despite the stink from his mouth and his body. Listen, asshole, what's your name?
Meth Cow.
Your name is Meth Cow? He nodded.
That's what they call me.
What's your real name? He thought for a moment, then shrugged.
I don't know. I used to work in a circus, in a barn mostly. I know there was firemen and this dog, this fine, heroic dog, and he bit me in the ass, and I had to get a shot. I don't remember much before then. People called me Meth Cow on account of how I dealt meth in the barn. You know, where cows stay?
I'll do my best to put the pieces together, sure.
And that scene. It's Money in the Bank. We're just this is illegal. We're just printing the cash now. This is pure. You could never print gold before this moment. We've discovered the Philosopher's Stone. And it's an awesome short story about the meth cow.
All right, now this final one here, I really think he runs into the magician.
Who is described as having spiky hair, wearing jeans and a t-shirt.
I made sure to keep the description in here, including one line that actually made me laugh out loud when I read it last night. But I think, Brian, you got to do double duty on this one. You got to play Brock and the magician.
Sure, I can rock that. If only I had a voice for this magician character all worked out.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Hold on. Let me we gotta get our mood music rocking. Here we go. All right, here we go.
Okay. In the middle of this tent sat a throne that seemed to be made out of knives. A man sat in that throne. The metal chair should have cut him to pieces, but it didn't seem to bother him the least. Fake candles flickered all around him. He was waiting for us.
Rabid Rabbi,
he said.
And Big Ugly Sockman.
I nodded. Magician.
Huh.
Brock said to the man.
I thought you'd be bigger.
The magician smiled.
Funny. Never heard that one before.
Truth be told, I also thought the guy would be bigger. Hell, I was bigger than he was, and that's saying something. He had short blonde hair done up in spikes. Skinny. In combat boots, jeans, a t-shirt, the magician didn't look like anything special. His looks, however, weren't a part of what made his reputation. The magician wasn't the only hitman on New Hope. Not even close. There were a lot of bad motherfuckers among the 500,000 people on the station. And there was enough criminal infighting to keep those hitmen gainfully employed. This guy, however, he was a cut above the rest. In a station that had no guns, you had to get up close and personal to take someone out. That, or know how to deliver poison, how to rig a lethal but low-yield bomb, or how to arrange an elevator accident or decompression event. Supposedly, the magician knew how to do all these things. And this was the man I had to deal with? At times like that, I wished real hard that I'd been just a little bit better as a fighter. A couple of big-ticket wins, some money in the bank, and it would have never wound up here. Yet here I was. Magician, we need to talk, I said. The president hired you to kill Ellen DeGeneres Jr., didn't he? The magician paused before answering.
I can neither confirm nor deny that information, Senator.
Brock looked at me.
You're a senator?
Figure a speech, I said to him. Then, to the magician, I said, we came for the president's money. The magician laughed.
Ha! Did you now? Let's say that I hypothetically accepted payment to do this dastardly deed. Someone in that line of work, I'd imagine, would be bound by reputation to fulfill the terms of any agreement.
You can't fulfill it anymore, I said. The president is dead. He nodded.
You think I wouldn't have heard about that already? Come on, Rabbi. Use your head.
He already knew? Well, then you know that Ellen DeGeneres Jr. moved faster than you did. She had the president whacked before you could whack her. Khan wanted her dead so he could win the election as president of the NHARP. I heard Brock sigh, and this time it wasn't a sigh of despondence. For the first time that day, he was getting pissed.
Just give us the money, you little
he said.
You have 3 seconds, then I'm coming over there and twisting your little head off your little neck. One.
The magician flicked his arm forward. There was a clank as a metal spike appeared between Brock's feet. The spike pointed back at an angle to the magician's knife chair. I saw that the knife chair now lacked symmetry. There was one extra decorative spike on the left than there was on the right. Brock looked at the spike between his feet. Sockman, I said, maybe this wasn't the right time to practice your intimidating look. He nodded.
Maybe not. It's kind of impressive, Rabbi. I'm actually kind of disappointed.
In?
I thought sorcerers used clouds of smoke and
The magician was tossing another spike back and forth from his left hand to his right.
I'm sorry, Big Ugly. Did I interrupt your count? I believe you were on two.
Brock looked up.
Was I? I was never very good at math, Mr. Magician. I don't recall ever being able to count higher than one.
The magician nodded.
Man's got to know his limitations. So, Rabbi, what's to stop me from just keeping the money?
The answer was nothing. But I had to try and appeal to whatever morals remained inside of a man who murdered people for money. You took those funds as payment for a service rendered, I said. That service was to help John Conn get reelected as president. Last I checked, they don't elect dead men. At least on New Hope, I hear dead people can still vote in Chicago back on Earth.
Voter fraud,
the magician said.
Such a crime.
Anyway, no matter who you kill, hypothetically, of course, you can't fulfill the service for which you were hired. So it seems logical to refund the money.
Refund it to you? It's not your money.
Now, I finally got to play my ace in the hole. You're right. It's not ours. It's Chad Latilton's. For the first time, I saw the magician's confidence waver. Maybe he ruled down here in a den of deviants and misfits, but Chad Latilton ran the other 17 decks. That wasn't a battle the magician wanted. He started spinning the spike in one hand like a drummer spins a drumstick. The twirling, flashing metal dancing between his fingers was damn near hypnotic.
And how would Latilton find out I have the money?
Because Brock and I would tell him. The magician smiled.
And if you and Brock died right here in this tent, hypothetically, of course, then who would tell him?
Would you like to find out what happens to our heroes? Go ahead and buy Bones Are White, the new short story collection from Scott Sigler. The only place where you'll read the complete unedited edition of Beam Up on Aisle 5. Complete with original characters from you, Chatrealm.
There's a little gumshoe cherry on top. Enjoy that. That's amazing, dude. I'm telling you, it's like I thought it was going to be cute and fun. I did not expect it to be good and engaging. It was awesome. Thank you so much, a million times over, for creating that little gem for us.
You're welcome. It was a little tough to get rolling and try and work all that stuff in there, but I used the wiki a bit to go grab some other extra stuff and just try and cram as much back knowledge in there as I could. Turned out to be pretty fun. So it was cool.
I'll tell you, my favorite was the there was a certain sports team. Should we tip who? There's so many more references. I don't want to give them all up, but there's a certain mascot.
No, yeah, everybody should just go get it. I mean, I think it's how much is the entire Bones Are White thing?
It's $4.99, the whole thing. It's $5.
Oh, good God, friends. Well, what do you want him to do? Just bleed on the internet and you lap up his blood and then just like rub it on your face like it's some sort of salve? Buy it for $4.99.
Well, I think it's a super cool experience for fans and for people in the chat realm, because I mean, I wrote this specifically based on everybody's input from the last show.
Have you ever done anything like that for anyone before?
No, I've never done anything like that before. No,
that's awesome. That is awesome.
Yeah. Well, here's the deal, folks. Go ahead and make sure that you get it. Bones Are White, and of course, the new book Nocturnal, which is just really taking off today. I'm so proud that it's blowing up. I just love to see. I mean, I know from my work with Andrew and everything that, you know, just the idea of just this kind of the fact that there, I know so many awesome creative people that do really awesome stuff just always brings me such joy. And everybody should go out and support artists that are really kind of making a difference and making art for us. I mean, there's the reason why we have a niche community of awesomeness now is because it caters to people like never before. And Scott's certainly one of those authors for anybody who listens to NSFW.
I think it's too early to declare the war over or peace talks beginning, but
We do appear to have received the first white flag from Time Warner Cable. So at least we're on their radar. Perhaps we could have peace negotiations. Maybe we could work something out here. I don't know.
Well, never. I will never lay down my arms. Never.
Until we go a full year of no dropping of the NSFW show, then the hashtag Chatrealm Gang Rapes TWC should be used.
No. Oh, my God.
All right, real quick, let's do some real quick house cleaning. Number one, can we take a look at the results from our Star Wars dance debate?
No, it magically vanished when my internet connection went down. No, apparently everyone decided you're right and that I'm wrong. I can't believe the See, the smart thing is that you couched yours as not disagreeing with me. Let me point
this out. I didn't write that.
Yeah, but that's your argument. That was your argument the whole time. Was not that I was wrong, but that I was irrelevant, which was a smart move.
Well, that was my opinion, yes.
Yeah.
But then also, speaking of the Star Wars connection.
Wow, look at this. Somebody already made Star Wars is dumb anyway. Squarespace.com. Who likes Star Wars? This guy, Star Wars kid. Dark helmet's better than Darth Vader. So Lone Star. Tough guy Vader. Yep, Star Wars sucks. Dedication is not always a good thing.
That's amazing.
Wow, dude, somebody really took your side. So you heard it here first. Justin's right because he thinks that Star Wars sucks.
I love Star Wars, but look at all these things that already exist. And we're going to get freaked out because Lando Calrissian's doing the two-step.
That's dumb people doing dumb stuff, not the, oh, I give up.
Yeah,
the poll wins. I go with democracy, fine, whatever.
And then also, I mean, do we have enough? Because halfway through this episode, we found out that we're cashing in a commission every time you guys buy.
I'm sorry to say we only have 58 copies sold, which means that's not enough to buy the $60 Star Wars Connect game. I'm sorry.
I don't know, Brian.
What a bummer.
I wonder if by the time,
Wait a minute. Kovacs. Look, hold on. Here's another poll that we won. What? Scott and Brian, Star Wars Dancing. Who do you agree
with?
There's like Scott
17
and Brian.
People that voted in that one.
Well, it was also.
Hey, you know what? Delaware sends people to the government too. Small populace. In the House of Reps, we're doing just fine. Thank you very much.
That's right. We got one senator that says that Star Wars Dancing is totally lame and or fake. Possibly gay.
Oh, by the way, apparently people are saying that the Star Wars Connect game is $49. Therefore, it has already been surpassed.
All right, so I guess we got whatever we have extra, we'll spend on a Han Solo costume.
Yes.
Oh, we need more money for a Han Solo costume. Good idea.
It's funny. My idea was to have Brian and Veronica play Game On. Or no, on Game On, play the Star Wars Connect dance game with Veronica dressed as Han Solo and Brian as Slave Leia.
Yeah.
So unless they're doing something funnier than that, then when that video comes out, be like, Justin's idea was funnier.
I'll tell you what, man. Maybe I will play and just get a 3-second shot of that. Of course, Bonnie's so done with me dancing with other guys. I even danced with another guy last week with Max Trollbot. Did you see that?
I have not seen it. No.
I guess you'll see it on Game On. You're going to have to tune in for Game On Sunday nights
tease. By the way, everybody go check out this week's episode. I thought it was a really awesome episode. The Glowing Stars were amazing. They played live in the studio, but if you dig chiptunes, go check that out. And Scott, where can people get more information on all things Sigler?
ScottSigler.com. That's where we give away free audiobook stories every Sunday. And a lot of stories, full audiobooks are available at Scott's podiobooks.com, which is podiobooks.com. Or the simple thing, just go on iTunes, search for Scott Sigler in quotes, and look at all the free audiobooks that you can grab. And don't forget, we're teetering on the edge of the New York Times bestseller list. All of you suckers with $17, just go get Nocturnal on Amazon. Do it right now. Here, I'll even paste it in the chat room. That's how easy I am.
Well, how very helpful you were. That's fantastic.
Boom, done. It's just that easy. It's so good.
That was easy. Now I'm going to click on it, and I'll show what that link looks like over here. There it is, Nocturnal. Oh, good looking.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great looking cover. And come on, support the good guys. Don't you want to see the good guys show up on the New York Times? It's usually just a bunch of nonsense, some self-help books, a bunch of people that want to feed your kids mercury through, you know, vaccine injections.
And number two right now is, coincidentally, a Star Wars book.
Interesting. Mm. Yes, I don't know what that means.
My first poop, a Jar Jar Binks animated guide to Star Wars, because it's such a pristine franchise that nobody screwed with before.
Me so poopy, me pants!
All right. Well, I guess that's it for this episode of NSFW then. By the way, don't forget the Scam School. As long as we're talking about books, ebooks, following in the footsteps of Scott Sigler. You remember I called you asking for advice on ebooks?
Yep.
Ended up getting it released and everything. It's at scamschoolbook.com. I could not be happier about it. You guys should definitely check it out. I'm going to go ahead and start wrapping things up here. NSFWshow.com is the place where you can see our stuff. Oh, if only there was one extra little gem, one little tidbit that we could throw in that would be interesting for everyone at home. But
it's
there's
time
not.
To go and I'm so
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute for the week of April 1st, 2012. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. Another week, another movie, and another entry on the scoreboard. Here's the rundown. Veronica Belmont, Tom Merritt, Sarah Lane, and Brian Brushwood are all twiddling their thumbs, waiting for their films to get released. Stuck in third place. In second place, with Wrath of the Titans bringing in a weak $33.4 million, it's Justin Robert Young. And with
the
Hunger Games bringing in $58.5 million this week, bringing his total to $248.4 million. In first place, it's Scott Johnson. And with that, week two is in the books. Ladies and gentlemen, that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of April 1st, 2012.
Sure, you're gonna make $1 billion, Justin.
Yeah.
Then do without Justin Robert Young for even a little while.
Dying of fire, kids.
Hey, see you next Tuesday.